Good afternoon to you. In London this week is the star of such films as The Nun's Story, The Pumpkin Eater, Far From the Madding Crowd, it's Peter Finch. And Peter Finch, your latest film, you actually sing in it, don't you? And I wondered whether you know, like I sing in the bath, but yeah. Do you sing in the bath pretending you were Benjamin Ajili, or was this a surprise that you had a voice?
No, it was a surprise. I've sung a couple of little things in Shakespeare, as I think all actors have. And I started in vaudeville, so I had done a bit of singing before, in the chorus. But I never imagined that I'd do a musical. I think we ought to draw a veil over my singing in a musical, because in all honesty, I can't say I did it, but these days with electronic help and popping a note in from somewhere else, I suppose you could make the janitor sing like Mario Lanza if necessary.
Shangri-La in that film in Tibet had a touch more than a touch of the Buddhist about it. Mm-hmm. And I believe your childhood had more than a touch of the Buddhist about it.
Yes. When I was very young, about 10, I had a grandmother who was the sort of Auntie Mame of her age. And she joined, I remember her vividly, she used to wear a gold band around her head and knitted dresses. And she joined any religion that went past the window, and or any cause. And at this particular stage, she decided that she was going to be a Buddhist, and we went off to Madras in India to a theosophical congress. And she thought it'd be a good idea if I was a Buddhist, so she sent me off with a Buddhist monk, and I had the yellow robe on and had my hair shaved off, and I lived with him for about 10 days.
Kind of very young Yul Brynner with your hair shaved off.
And we put the begging bowls outside, and I didn't understand what he was talking about. And then the British Raj heard about it and got incensed. And I can just remember carloads of officers and policemen coming and grabbing me and giving me back to my grandmother. If they hadn't, you know, perhaps I might have been in Shangri-La by now.
Shangri-La in the film, which, I mean, I must confess, reminded me a little bit of a municipal park without the flower clock.
Some American critics said it looked like the Tibet Hilton. There is an element of that.
But in fact, the marvellous story of Shangri-La, this place that is so beautiful and so ideal and so moderate, as John Gielgud says in the film, has also got that tremendous sort of happy, settled feeling about it. Mm-hmm. And there are you, as Mr. Conway, deciding, in fact, to take up that settled life. And in real life, this is far from what you've done.
That's true. I think by virtue of the fact, the sort of life I've led, that I've become a nomad. And I don't seem to be able to settle anywhere for a long time, and I like it that way. But at the risk of being pompous, you see, I don't think that Shangri-Las are valleys that you go to. They're things that you invent inside yourself. And I perhaps carry my own with me.
I mean, you could identify...
A sort of portable Shangri-La.
Shangri-La, yes. But did you mean that by that you could identify with that man's desire for this?
Yes, I think that's deep in all of us. I think not to cop out and at the same time find some kind of internal peace and surroundings perhaps where... One feels peace and happiness. Well, it's not a new desire in man. This story is not the first time it's been written. Virgil wrote about it in the Arcadians, and there's Utopia. It seems to be an eternal desire of mankind to escape to this kind of valley.
Did you have a very unsettled childhood? I mean, your parents split up, and you weren't brought up by your parents, were you?
No, I was brought up by various aunts and this wonderful grandmother. And I lived in England till I was 2, and then in France. I went to school in France, then I lived in India for 2 years, and then went to Australia. So I've been travelling all my life. And I've found that I've got used to travelling. I lived in Jamaica for a while recently, and I thought I'd settled there, and I had a marvellous house on top of a hill, and one day I saw a cargo boat going by, and that was it. I was off again.
You said you had a wonderful grandmother. My theory about grandmothers is that they ought to be eccentric, quite honestly.
Oh, yes. You know, everybody should have an eccentric grandmother.
I think so. Yeah. In fact, I aim to be one.
Well, I'd like to be an eccentric grandfather. In fact, I probably am by now.
Now, in fact, though, do you think that you did go from job to job, didn't you? Mm-hmm. You found it quite hard to find what you wanted to do. Is that right?
Yeah, well, for sheer economics, I left school at during the Great Depression, and I had to do all sorts of jobs. And I was a cowboy and a journalist and one thing or another. And I really slipped into acting for sheer economics, to eat. I went into vaudeville. And then I found, I thought that if one had to go through life, one might as well go through life with these cheerful idiots. And I've been with the cheerful idiots ever since.
Do you think at all, though, that, I mean, it always, you know, well, I suppose because I'm a mother and I want a settled life for my children. Mm-hmm. And I also believe that because of my childhood, which was very settled, you know, that it gave me a very good foundation in some ways. And do you think that because you didn't have a settled family life, that this made it very difficult for you to find something you wanted to do? In fact, were you at all frightened of settling somewhere or putting yourself at somebody's...
It's not a conscious thing in me, but I now realise that I do tend to run away from that, from being trapped into a settled existence.
But because you're afraid to depend on someone because of your...
Yes, I think I was afraid to depend, and also a habit. It's a habit now, you know. If you keep moving as much as I have, I feel that you go on doing it.
But, I mean, do you think in any way at all it's influenced your view of family life and the way that you've brought up your children or haven't brought up your children or whatever it is that you've done?
I don't think I'm the ideal father, but I try now with the little Diana. I have to, by nature of my work, leave the boy in a boarding school because I was 5 months in America and 2 months here and a month there, and you can't drag them around, otherwise they get no education. But I take the little daughter with me because I like to be with them and together. It's very difficult for an actor who's working hard, I think, to operate the family life. Fortunately, I have Alita who likes floating around with me. It's very difficult with the children, and I perhaps haven't done it as well as I should.
Do you think it's regrettable not to have had a settled life in that way once you've got children or
no,
not?
No, never having had it, I don't miss it.
No.
In fact, I recoil in horror at the thought of a cottage with roses round the door and mother-in-laws and things all sitting on top of each other.
Can we go back to where you began in acting, how you got into it?
Well, as I said, I did it as sheer economics, and I was looking for a job like everybody else in Sydney, and I was in a dosh house, actually, a Salvation Army dosh house. And I saw an advertisement in the paper where they wanted a straight man for a comedian at the Maccabean Hall. And I, having come from France and England, had what the Australians described as a toffee voice. And so they said, well, you'd be a good straight man for a comedian. And I went down, and much to my surprise, I got the job. I did a little acting at school, and I got the job with this marvelous old fellow called Bert LeBlanc, and I hoofed in the chorus. I remember we used to wear one sad sort of comic memory I have of it was at the height of the Depression, doing a Saturday matinee done in a pink frayed pink dinner suit with three members in the audience on a rainy day with their coat collars turned up, and we were all singing, "We're in the money, come on, man," you know. And the sadness of it all, and the wonder of it. And from there I drifted into radio, mostly radio in Sydney, and the theatre and cinema.
Do you like radio, in fact? I mean, because they don't see you. I mean, always since you've got a handsome face.
I like it because I'm used to it. I did a lot in Sydney. I was in the sort of the wild days of radio, much the same equivalent as the great days of Orson's radio in America. It was my same period in Sydney, and I must say we had a lot of fun and some very, very funny times going from one show to the other in a taxi, and we used to go on without rehearsing, and you never knew what was coming up on the page, and some very funny things came up on the page.
When you were then in Australia, did you come to England to act? I mean, how did you get into a bigger time than that, so to speak?
Well, after war I had my own company, the Mercury Theatre, named in honour of Orson's company, and the Olivias were touring in Australia, and they saw me, and they were marvellous, and they said, why don't you come to England? And I stuck with the Mercury until it collapsed, unfortunately, and then came over, and Sir Lawrence, Lord Olivier, put me on contract, and I did three plays with his company, and from then on I was launched in the English theatre.